Thank you. I appreciate your pointing that out.
Julia Louis-Dreyfus this afternoon on All Things Considered from NPR News.
All Things Considered comes your way at 4 today on WHYY.
Stocks are falling sharply on Wall Street after President Trump said he would respond to China's latest tariff increase and called on U.S. companies to consider alternatives to doing business in China. Earlier, China said it would retaliate against the latest round of tariffs imposed by Washington with duties on $75 billion of U.S. products. U.S. officials confirmed that Israel was responsible for the bombing of an Iranian-backed militia's weapons depot in Iraq last month. The attack would mark a significant escalation in Israel's long campaign against Iranian military entrenchment across the region. France has accused Brazil's president of having lied to French President Emmanuel Macron in a sharp escalation of tensions over fires ravaging the Amazon. France has threatened to block a European Union trade deal with South American states, including Brazil. You're listening to Aaron.
This is WHYY. It's 119. The forecast for the weekend looks really good. The rain should clear out. Sunshine tomorrow, high near 80, partly sunny Sunday, up to about 75. If you plan to head to the beach, don't forget, WHYY reaches some of your favorite beaches. You can hear the same programs you love on 90.9 across most of South Jersey. Just turn the radio dial a little bit lower. For more information about WHYY's five dial positions in New Jersey, visit WHYY.org/FM.
For over 40 years, the stories on Morning Edition have been your stories, your lives, your world.
I saw this man who was...
Think I'll be okay?
Just... Couldn't I hear this cute game?
I sat with him on the couch.
This is where, you know, I've been able to come.
And the sound of Morning Edition, it's the sound of you. This is Morning Edition every day from NPR News. Weekday mornings from 5 and 7 on WHYY.
Providing a pre-K through grade-level engineering curriculum, from lead engineer to engineering the future, with teacher guides, storybooks, kits, and videos all designed to fuel dynamic STEM education. More at MOS.org. Here it is. She shattered the glass ceiling in 1968, and she became the first mathematical conference. She was famously. Decades later, that's still impossible for many women of color. It's called The Club, What Women of Color Need to Know to Secure a Seat at the Table. Mindy Hartz, welcome to the now.
Thank you, Martha. Happy to be here.
So, at the beginning of the show, we give the reasoning for why we're
feeling that's bad,
specifically for women of color.
You can learn how to really be yourself.
You went through the Rachel Sanders book, Lean In, which for those who don't know, is kind of the holy grail for women's empowerment and how to get a seat at the table. But when you were done, you were disappointed. What was missing for you?
Yeah, I was disappointed because so many women, I put that in quotations, were excited about this book, but I didn't see myself as a black woman or a woman of color in the book. I felt that it's hard to be when you're not even in the room. I don't think you address some of those issues that some of us face. Everyone doesn't experience what you're saying.
And what are some of those issues?
Race. Acknowledge that not all feelings are created equal. We have the wage gap between black and brown women is much different than Caucasian women. And I think that, you know, Cheryl wrote from a place of privilege. Now, I don't take it away that that is her story, that is what she drew from, but I think that there are many nuances to the table, and I felt like it was time for black and brown women to finally be able to shake their head up and down and read some of the common things that we experience when we try to lean in.
And talking a little bit about that disparity, you mentioned leadership roles in Fortune 500 companies and board positions specifically. 28% of women hold board positions for Fortune 500 companies, but that number is much lower in the single digits for black and brown women. You also talk a bit about the labels and the stereotypes and how they come into play when you are in different situations. So, for instance, the angry black woman, the feisty Latina, the docile Asian and how that comes into play in your interactions when you're dealing with coworkers and colleagues. Do you have a specific story that stands out for you?
One of the women that I spoke with while writing the book, she told me that her white male boss could never remember her name and made her wear a name tag, and she was there for 7 years. And when she went to speak on about it, they told her, don't be the angry black woman. And it's like, well, how are you supposed to feel working somewhere for 7 years and you were always getting my name wrong, you know? So it's things like that, that we don't even have the agency to speak out on at times.
You often talk a lot in the book about microaggressions. I once had a boss who kept calling me Detroit Tanya. That's where I'm from originally. But he kept saying, I want to see Detroit Tanya, not this polished Tanya that I see. And I sort of felt that that was a microaggression of sorts, because what he was seeing is actually Tanya. And you had a story similar to that with the nail polish thing when you were working in corporate America and someone mentioned the colors that you were wearing.
Yes, absolutely. Microaggressions and bias are real. And when I was in corporate America, my manager commented on my nail color, which at the time it was summertime, and so I had on the color burnt orange. And he said, you people love your bright colors. And he joked with another white male colleague for about 15 minutes about how black people like bright colors.
Yeah. The numbers, the statistics are out there on the percentages of women who are in leadership positions. And in talking about the wage disparity, black women in the United States on average are paid about 61 cents for every dollar paid to white non-Hispanic men. This book, though, is a how-to book on ways that women can get a seat to the table. So let's start talking a little bit about your tips. You say that number one, you should build your squad both internally and externally. Talk a little bit about what that is and why that's important.
Yes, we talk a lot about networking. I think it's so important and crucial for women of color if we want the seat at the table. And I realize not everybody wants that, and that's okay too. And so figuring out, do you want to secure your seat? And that will require you to build what some may see as allyship, build relationships with key stakeholders in the organization and your colleagues that you work with side by side, but having people who can speak on your behalf when you're not in the room. And for me in particular, it was building that squad, that team inside the workplace that helped me secure my seat at the table.
And you also talk about really getting to know your colleagues and your coworkers. It's something that we often think, okay, you're playing a game, but this game is important because you find your other colleagues are also doing this.
Absolutely. You know, I hate that the game is still in motion, right? This like imaginary game of life that we're all playing inside the workplace, but there are some things to do and navigate to get that seat, and then we can bring others along with us so that we don't have to experience the isolation. But I found when I built my squad inside the workplace that I had many more opportunities to thrive and not just survive.
Yeah, and building your team and also playing that game. That means after work, taking the time to go out for drinks or for golf, as we always use that as an example. Getting to know your coworkers and colleagues and their personal lives and opening yourself up to allow them to get to know you as well.
Yes, because I think, at least for me, when I entered the workplace, we were told just do your job and put your head down, right? So we didn't go to the after work activities. We didn't maybe go to the break room when the birthdays were happening. And I think two things happen. People get to see us in a different way, but then we also get to observe those who could be potential squad members, because not everybody at work is your friend and wants to see you win. And so you may not always know that about them just passing them casually on the way to get coffee.
What are some other ways that white allies within the workplace can help, can be a part of producing that culture? Maybe they are not even in leadership positions, but they may be your coworkers and your colleagues.
Yes, absolutely. One of the things that I talk about was an experience that I was going through of being one of the only black women in the workplace. And when the situation was happening, the situation caused me to be an advocate for myself, but then my white coworkers just watched it all go down, and in secrecy they would come and see if I was okay and say, sorry you're going through this. But when they had the opportunities to speak up about it in public, they did not stand up for me. And I think that if you're a colleague of any color or gender, I think it's important to be there in public and also educating yourself and using books like The Memo to see what you've been doing, what how have you been contributing to some of the discomfort that women of color have been experiencing in the workplace? And I think it requires that education piece to truly be an ally.